Hello, this is Neil Buchanan with Rock Our World. I'm on a roll this morning. I've had to redo two videos because the Lord gave me more information. So this episode is called All About Demons. And I've talked a bit about this in a lot of episodes, how the Christian church and I expect the Jewish church also to a certain extent, they don't talk much about demons. The reason being that Satan, our enemy, is the god of this world, and he's in charge of churches, church boards, synagogues. He's in charge of everything, and he controls the minds of the men, and I won't say 100%, but for the most part. And anyway, somewhere back in history, he convinced men to get rid of three books. Those three books are the Book of Enoch, the Book of Jubilees, and the Book of Jasher. And actually, I was going over these three books with some friends yesterday, and one of the concerns they expressed when you read the Book of Jasher, it just seems so completely unbelievable, some of the weird stuff that they're talking about. At any rate, I developed a few strategies to, and I'll talk more about this specific book in a future episode, because that's not the point of this one, but I'll just throw in that for a heads up and a help. As unbelievable as some of those things are in Jasher, they're no more unbelievable than the stories of Samson and Gideon and David and his mighty men. And there's a long list of, how about Joshua asking God to stop the sun in the sky? And they actually can prove, NASA, and I'm going to get some more information on this, but they have absolute proof that we are a full day off. The sun actually did get stopped for a full day. And of course, if you believe God, you knew that already. But these unbelievable things are done by a God who has no limitations. He's 1 trillion times smarter and more powerful than we are. So another strategy with Jasher is to look up and read the full account of Zipporah. In our record, in our Torah, the story of Zipporah is just one line, and it just seems completely out of place. And there's no information. It's not enough to make any sense of it. So then go to Jasher and read the full account. And anyway, I'll get back to those things in the later episodes. But in these three books that were kicked out of the record of God's Word, they give a lot of information about demons. And in particular, the Book of Enoch talks about its beginnings, the beginnings where demons came from, how they were created in a place that was outside of God's instructions. What became the fallen angels, they interacted and married and produced offspring with beautiful women that were physical women. And I'll give you a bit of detail on how this happened. And of course, this isn't, I'm speaking out of my own belief and heart and everything, and I'm trusting myself. I'm trusting that the Holy Spirit has revealed these things to me. And time will prove those kind of things out. So the following is my opinion, obviously, because I can't go to scriptures to get the full details of what I'm going to talk about. But I feel the Holy Spirit's revealed this. That what happened is there was about 200 angels that were sent down to earth in the early stages, after Adam and Eve were created and they started to procreate and fill the earth. These 200 angels, and I'm going to say they were higher rank angels, they were given this responsibility and called watchers, and their job that the Lord gave them was to take care of humans, just watch over them, and probably giving them, help and keeping them straight, keep them on the Torah, keep them on the straight and narrow, I'm not sure how that was to come about, but at any rate, these 200 angels went outside the bounds of their authority. They started to lust after these beautiful females, these beautiful human women that were being produced, you know, by the procreation of men as they populated the earth, and they started watching, you know, how men had and women had this what seemed to be a beautiful sexual relationship, and they were lusting after them, and that wasn't what they were supposed to be doing, and they knew better. So they there was a ringleader amongst them, and you can read all this in the book of Enoch. The ringleader called everybody to a meeting, let's say, and said, look, I know we're all thinking the same thing. We want those beautiful ladies, and we know God doesn't approve of that. Now, you shouldn't even be thinking about it. And tell you what, if we're in this together, we all float or die together. And they died together. Well, spirits don't die, but they're in a prison right now awaiting judgment, and a very harsh judgment. What could have been an eternity of great esteem and wonder, they have traded it in on eternity of horror and separation from God. But their judgment still awaits, and Enoch talks about all that stuff. And anyway, back to the story, they figured out how to get their wives, they married wives, you know, they courted them, dated them, you know, and they married them. And of course, the women themselves were out of line too. They knew better, you know, if they were following God's instructions, they knew they weren't to be with these spirit beings. And anyway, a spirit has no ability physically to reproduce. So what the spirits did, they figured out how to harvest sperm from humans and animals. And they did it through the three acts of masturbation, of oral sex, and anal sex. And they harvested sperm. And remember, the demons are 20 times smarter than we are. You know, they use all their brain power, and God is a trillion times smarter than all of us. At any rate, they harvest sperm from animals and humans and introduced those sperm into the fertility tract of their wives, and children were produced. And the children came out in three categories, and you know, there may be more. The Ephesians talks kind of indicates there might be four, but there's only three I'm aware of. And the first one were the Nephilim. They were the giants. And I'm going to say that, and you know, a lot of this is me talking, but I'm putting together pieces. Once you read these three books, you'll see all the background. But the giants were the best of the best. They probably could be described as when farmers raise cattle, they choose the very best sire and the very best of the female in the herd, and they try to manage and bring the quality of their herd higher and higher and higher, using the best quality females and males. So the angels, being very much smarter than us, the fallen angels, they did use this process. They took the best of the best, and they produced giants, and they were beautiful. They're beautiful, and they're powerful, and they're the top levels of government in the demonic hierarchy. And then the second level were half animal, half human in appearance, and those would be like the centaurs. And we have lots of names for these, and you're going to see some of these in these books. And we have movies, you know, and we think it's mythology, but it's all true. These demons appear, they appear to be half human and half animal. And again, you know, that was a mixture of genetic material from animals and humans mixed together. And then the third level are grotesque looking things, anywhere from froggy, lizardy, slobbery, ugly, slimy, drooling. They all have a very, a gross and perverted sexual component. And those would be like the gargoyles would be one of the things that we see. But at any rate, all of this was very, very evil. It was all produced in an evil place outside the boundaries of God's instructions. And God was aware of all this happening. In fact, I'm going to say he expected it to happen. It was part of his plan. He needed, in a sense, a very strong sense, God needed an evil force to produce his bride. Let's say, we'll go right to the end of the story. He's looking for his bride, and he needs this battle or this challenge between good and evil, and it was put forth to us in the scriptures quite a number of times when God said, I put before you life and death. Choose life. And God orchestrated the components that allowed this evil to begin, and then he allowed it to be part of the process, and he's in control of everything. The demons will not be here forever. They will be put in a prison, and they'll be separated from humans, but they made those choices. God didn't make them do that. They made those choices completely on their own. They're 100% their responsibility. And then thus we ended up with this, there's the choice of good and bad before us. And he needed that to produce this bride. And then, of course, the second army, very important also, the large group that John saw besides the 144,000, that was the first and second army. And then all of us who are the church today, we're the third army. And God is turning the heat up, and he's pulling his bride out of this huge, awful, immature, leaderless, instructionless, Torahless church, both Christian and Jewish. We haven't been following God's ways. We haven't been studying the scriptures. We haven't been interpreting anything properly. We haven't been producing our doctrines based on the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. And I should have looked this scripture up. I'll pop it in a bubble. But the Lord tells us that there's three things that identify a man of God or a woman of God, a person of God. They will teach the Torah is one of them. They will understand the ways of the Lord, and they will teach them correctly to the people in their influence. And anyway, I'll put in a bubble those three things. It's not coming to my mind at the moment, but the very first one and the most important one is that they understand and teach the Torah. And we've got a real challenge, especially within the Christian church, to get rid of that false teaching that the Torah has been done away with. And then we got the background on where demons came from, and that they're here on earth, and their primary purpose is to thwart the coming of God's kingdom, to thwart his purposes. And the most basic building block of the entire creation is the marriage between a man and a woman. And if Satan is focusing all of his greatest resources on destroying marriages. Thus, we have a 50% marriage failure, and the 50% that stay together are I'm going to say, mostly unhappy in some way, shape, form, or degree. And Satan appears to be winning that battle, but God's about to turn it all around. He's giving us real good information on straightening things out. And it all comes from learning to hear God's voice and then starting to follow his strategy. He will give a strategy for every individual situation. The Christian church, well, the whole world is really bad for this. They have success once, and so then they write a book. And they have this belief that then that particular thing should always be done this particular way. And that's completely wrong. The book might give you a few pointers, but that's not how God will do. He'll repair the same situation, i.e. a marriage, in a different way for every couple, because every person and every couple, every marriage is unique. And he's the only one who knows how to fix it. So both husband and wife, you know, the most effective way to fix the problem is both husband and wife get on their knees and they become broken before the Lord, and they learn the scriptures. You know, make sure you're studying those scriptures every day, the Torah, the prophets, and the writings, and asking the Holy Spirit to, you know, explain it to you. And hopefully all the videos that I'm producing are will be an asset to speed this whole process along. And at any rate, it won't take you very long at all, and you'll be hearing God's voice. And once you learn how to hear God's voice, and he doesn't speak in words. I mean, he can obviously do that, but he doesn't. He speaks into our heart, and we have a strong impression that whatever came into our heart wasn't us. It just seems like it just invaded our thought. And he'll do that with a different way with everybody. The Holy Spirit will work a little bit different with everybody, so I can only describe how he's doing it with me. And the process is taking, it seems to me, took forever for me to learn how to hear God's voice and to just step it up so I'm hearing God's voice all the time, you know, like regularly, every day. And what he's doing with me right at the present is he wakes me up in the night. And it'll almost always be on the hour, like on our the clock that we have. And it'll be like 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock. And as soon as I wake up, he'll be teaching me something. And I believe there's two reasons why he's doing that to me. Is when I go back in my history, my battle with Satan, of depression, the devil, or my enemy, would wake me up at 2 o'clock every night for, it's got to be years. I thought I was going to die, and I would be immediately filled with anxiety. 2 o'clock, instant anxiety. I'd fight that battle till 5 o'clock, and I'd finally be able to go back to sleep and get a couple hours before I had to get up and just, you know, live my life exhausted all the time, because I had a short sleep and then a battle with a high level of adrenaline and a knot in my stomach, and it was just horrible. I was sure I should die. It was so horrible. But then the Lord taught me what was going on, and he gave me strategies of how to learn and fight and defend myself. And then now we're getting into the realm of the strategies, how to go into enemy territory and take back land that's been stolen from our enemy. So anyway, the Lord's been waking me up, and this past night, like this morning I'm teaching this, just a few hours ago, he woke me up exactly at 2 o'clock. This has been a very important day for me and the Lord. He reminded me of how the devil had done that all those years. And now here he is. He's waking me up. And he instantly, I had something happen yesterday. I'll back this story up a bit. About 5 o'clock yesterday, I had this real strong oppression come upon me. I just started feeling really almost depressed, but just really an oppression, you know, something very dark. No, not dark. It's not the right word. I knew it was from God, so it wasn't depression, but it was. He was doing something to me, and I kept asking, "What is this, Lord? Why do I feel so oppressed? Why do I have this burden?" That's a better way to put it. I was burdened, and he didn't seem like he was answering me. And I tried everything. I got out of my truck and I went in a ditch and fell flat in my face, and I I said, Lord, what's going on here? And there's a whole bunch of things going on that are just going south. Everything's just nasty. A whole bunch of situations are just being piled up. And anyway, I phoned my wife, and I phoned a prayer warrior who's been backing us up, and nothing coming to me. So I finally drove home, and I just hung around this burden, and my wife and I talked about it, and nothing coming to us, and went to sleep, and unfortunately we both got asleep, and I was restful, and at exactly 2 o'clock, the Lord woke me up, and instantly he was teaching me what that was all about, that he had put that burden on me, and what had happened is I had a teaching I thought was complete, and it was this one I'm doing right now with the demons, and the one right before it, and it's now called the Holy Spirit versus the Ahab Spirit. Anyway, he taught me a whole bunch of stuff, but it wasn't complete, and I didn't realize it. So he woke me up 2 this morning, and he completed the teaching, and now I have the information to redo these 2 videos, number 18 and 19, I believe. Anyway, they're called, maybe 17. Anyway, it's called the Holy Spirit versus the Ahab Spirit. Formerly, it was called the Holy Spirit versus the Control Spirit. And I was corrected and given more information. And so then the new title is the Holy Spirit versus the Ahab Spirit. And now this one right after it, I'm going to say it's 18, but anyway, you'll see what it is. I had to redo all about demons, and because I was missing this information. So that's just the beginning teaching on demons. It's really important because they are they're our enemy, as Ephesians 6:12 says. We do not struggle against flesh and blood, but against wicked spirits in high places. There's more words in there, but the hierarchy of Satan's government, their primary focus is on marriage, because it's the most basic building block of the kingdom. So I'm going to leave it at that. There's more to come, and especially as the Lord reveals more to me and to many other people. I have this theory, and it's based on Elijah's confrontation with the 450 prophets of Easter and the 400 prophets of Baal. I just learned that here recently. I read that scripture. I'm sure I've read it a million times. Not a million. I mean, 1,000 times. I never noticed these 450 prophets of Easter. Anyway, his confrontation, and he won. It was a slam dunk victory. The Lord backed him up and licked everything up, you know, in this confrontation. You know, it was a standoff, you know, or a showdown. It was a showdown, you know, and Elijah won. Anyway, right after that, interestingly enough, Jezebel put a reward on his head, and Elijah went fleeing to a cave, and he was just whining to the Lord, you know, I'm the only one in the whole universe that's trying to do your stuff. And the Lord says, Elijah, I got 5,000. I have this theory that what I'm doing here on this rock, our world, there's another 5,000 guys and girls and women and so on doing the same thing somewhere on this earth. And together we're, the leading edge. I'm speculating my opinion and all that stuff. The Lord's work has just been turned up a notch. We're shifted gears. We're now in the last days. And the birth pangs of the Messiah will become more and more intense, and Babylon is going down, and we're going to see struggles in economy. The world economy is going to continue to unravel. We'll have more and more money problems. We'll be losing our jobs. Our cities will become more and more chaotic, and eventually we got to leave those cities because they're just getting to be lawless. And the Lord will at the same time be getting places ready for refuge and safety and teaching. And the ones that want to respond to the leave of the Holy Spirit, you know, he's going to look after them. And he's going to teach them and raise them up and comfort them and protect, you know, from all this evil that's going around. And it's all going to be very miraculous and very supernatural. And at the same time, incredible signs and wonders. And I believe one has just begun, and I'm going to talk about it. It's a bird that's been on my farm for, well, since I was farming, but a little boy, I remember this bird, the mourning dove. And he just took me through a most amazing thing. He just created a miracle. Anyway, I got to confirm that, and I'll get back to you on the mourning dove. But be assured, we're in troubled times, and it's time to pay attention and do something about it. So, see you next time on Rock Our World, Daniel 2.